What is up, everyone? Welcome back to Apocalypse Movies and the first official episode of the Fandalorian Club. Yes, we are calling it the Fandalorian Club. It is our review special, spoiler discussion, heavy podcast. We're discussing everything The Mandalorian. It officially is out. Disney Plus is ready to go. And we have watched the first episode of The Mandalorian. It is available for everyone. Second episode comes out on Friday. Before we get going into some discussion, just a little bit of preview of what the show is going to be about. Essentially, we are just going to talk about it in full, heavy spoilers. We're not going to hold back. We're going to do everything we possibly can to dive into everything that it teases, that it shows, canon, connections, whatever. We're going to do it here, and we're going to do it after every single episode. So look out for that. You'll have two this week, and then one come the following weeks as the episodes come out. And so I'm your host, Jake Berlin. On our Star Wars podcast, the Padawan Podcast, I go by Qui-Gon Jake. And today, joining me is Mr. Grand Admiral Sino himself, Brian Avellino.
Dang pig.
Keep forgetting the pig. It is okay. But we are here to talk The Mandalorian. We just got done watching the episode. And there's, you know, a shorter episode.
Very short.
A lot to talk about, a lot to digest. We may not be able to digest it all. Because it is just 10 minutes out from watching it as we jumped on the cameras here. But before we're getting to some, you know, maybe some connections and spoiler stuff, just initial reactions. What did you think of the episode overall compared to your anticipation? And did it live up to the hype?
I would say yes to everything you just said there. I can't get over how real everything looks and how amazing everything looked. Like, the puppet guy that you were saying,
Nolte. That's not his actual name in the story, but it's voiced by Nick Nolte.
Yeah, it looks so real. Mm-hmm. And even the aliens, like everything, I couldn't get over it. And I love the oh my god, I've literally been saying their names for the last like 10 minutes. The creatures that they ride.
Oh, the
starts with a B.
The Borgs.
Borgs. The Borgs. I love the Borgs. With their little T-Rex arms. But yeah, no. It's crazy. It's so weird to think this is a TV show. It's not a movie.
I know.
Yeah. And I kept doing that a couple times. Like, oh, this is a good one. Oh, this is a TV show.
$15 million an episode. $10 to $15 million an episode.
It's wild. And it shows. I mean, it definitely shows. Cause
yeah, there wasn't really a moment where I was like, oh, that's bad special effects.
No, not at all. Yeah. Not at all.
Not surprised with Jon Favreau at the helm.
Well, Dave Filoni's not going to put a half-assed stamp on anything he does. Especially if it's Star Wars. So, I mean, and this is literally his child.
Yeah.
Like, in all
senses. Well, this is Jon Favreau's child.
Well, yeah, that's true.
He's just directing.
Yeah, but yeah. It was wild.
Yeah, no, I loved it. I think that it was a great first step for this TV show. Mm-hmm. It's the first ever live-action TV show, obviously, for Star Wars. It's a long time coming, but it did exactly what it needed to do as far as preparing you for the medium that it's being told on, Disney Plus, TV show, smaller budget, not on the big screen, right? It's kind of a shell shock for some people because we've only ever experienced Star Wars on the movies. You know, we have the television shows like Rebels and Clone Wars and stuff like that. Yeah. But it also, it hooked you with the story, and mm-hmm. it wasn't just, you know, as Alex Damon said it in his kind of little review there, it's not just a cool guy doing cool things mm-hmm. In cool areas, you know what I mean? It's not just a butt-kicking show where he's dressed up in Mandalorian armor, he has a cool name, he has a reputation, and he goes out and kicks some arse. And so it's much more than that.
Arse,
because I didn't want to say the actual word. So it's much more than that, and I appreciate that. I'm not surprised that it's that, but obviously that's what we wanted from the get-go. We wanted something deeper, and being Star Wars and the connection and the lore that it has, that's what we expect, and it delivered on that front. But there are some things that we can really, really get into, and there are some things that we could talk about that we may not have liked, but let's kind of break this down in section because the episode almost happened in three different parts here. Let's start with the opening sequence, you know, going for the initial bounty, learning who this guy really is on this ice planet. And then essentially let's stop And we'll take about 30 minutes on this show. This is kind of how it's going to go. But right before he meets up with Greef Karga, that's kind of where we're going to get to. So just the initial sequence here for the opening of the show, I thought it was a good showing. Obviously, he kicks some butt, and it's cool. I love seeing the alien creatures in there. The big one with the big long tentacles, which is really cool because it's the first time we've ever seen that in live action. The alien makeup and costumes is incredible.
It's
incredible.
I have a hard time thinking you could do much better than that.
Yeah, I mean, it looks amazing. It looks realistic, which is just which is a clear-cut favorite. But I will say that it was very predictable. It was a predictable showing, but I think it did, like what we had said, it did what it needed to do. It wanted to kind of introduce us to this guy. You know, he's a no-named assassin, essentially. He does his bidding. It's a fun way to do it. But I think it went over very well, and it did what it needed to do in introducing us to this character that we have no idea who he is. And we were interested in him and intrigued by him right away.
Yeah. One thing I really noticed about the episode more than anything is pretty much all of the stuff we saw in the trailers was in this episode.
Well, that happens a lot with TV, though.
Which, at first, I was kind of like, oh, man, like, really? But then I'm kind of like...
That's better.
That's what I'm saying. I'm sitting here thinking, I have no idea what to expect now.
And we also have to admit, you and I, we only watched the first trailer. So we don't know what other stuff showed.
Exactly.
So for our viewings,
for it's you different. And I, yeah. So, I mean... Yeah, there's a lot more that we probably haven't seen, and we're purposely not seeing. I kind of like it, because I'm sure there was stuff that we saw in this episode that was shown in the trailer that we kind of got a little bit more surprised about. But, I mean, yeah, it was wild. I mean, the bounty hunter scene in the beginning, when he's literally... going after the guy, a little predictable. Like, once you saw them beating up the guy, you were like, okay, well, it's gonna end up being about the bounty. At least to me it was. But I mean, to me it really showed kind of like this is definitely like in the rough spot after the sixth movie. Mm-hmm. Like, they're not It's not like everyone's got money, everyone's having a good time. No, this is like hard times. So.
Yeah, I mean, that kind of leads us into the next part of the episode where we meet Greef Karga, played by Carl Weathers, on a different planet. And he's, you know, he's kind of walking through this town. We see a different atmosphere in the world of Star Wars. And that's where we learn, you know, the bounty hunting business is, it's tough. You know, prices aren't as high as they usually are. You know, he's looking for bounties, but nothing is paying as much as he wanted. And the key thing in this meetup with those two is the Imperial credits. This kind of might tell a lot of the character of the Mandalorian. We can just call him Mando for short if we want to, but, Carl Weathers, Greef Karga, he offers him for the four bounties he had, Imperial credits. He didn't want them.
The full and, amount.
Yeah. And, This could obviously be for a number of reasons. It could be for the fact that the Empire, like he said, the Empire is gone. But Greef Karga does say Imperial credits still pay. Or this could maybe be a fact of maybe he has a vengeance against the Empire because of what they did to him or his family or wherever he's from. Because
that what you took it as?
We'll talk about this later. But I took this episode. This episode was a clear cut answer to me that he's not a Mandalorian. And he's someone else, and he was picked up by the Mandalorians at some point after that flashback that happened. But that's kind of what I took it as, is maybe he doesn't want to deal with Imperial credits because he has maybe like a vengeance or revenge factor against them. Okay, I don't know how you feel.
You and I are very far off on this.
Okay, what did you think?
I think he didn't want the Imperial credits because the Empire's dead. He doesn't know how long the money's going to be worth.
Yeah, like he says, they're not, like, the Empire's gone.
Yeah, it's... I mean, it's not really worth anything anymore. I do think that he is a Mandalorian.
Okay.
But...
Should make a bet.
Add it to the board. I think he is a Mandalorian, but he was abandoned from what we saw. His parents were killed and basically was raised as a normal kid and now is trying to get back to his roots, essentially. Because they kind of made that... When he was talking to, like, the armor, the blacksmith, if you will, like, to me, I kind of got, like, that sense, like, this is getting you closer to what you, you should be and stuff. Which, that shocked me probably almost more than anything was that there were other Mandalorians there wearing the armor and stuff. Like, there, it's like a mini city.
Before we go to that, I want to say two quick things. One, I love the Calamari Flan.
That was
the Mon Calamari currency is called Calamari Flan, and that is effing incredible. The way it looks, effing incredible.
They look like it's water.
Like little gel packets, yeah. Essentially. Which Calamari Flan? I want Calamari Flan. That's amazing.
They used with the Mon Calamari, yes, is amazing.
Second thing, I don't think you caught this, but when he was asking for the bounty pucks and Grief Karga was going through them and he said, wanted smuggler.
I heard you. Well, yeah, you went, so I'm assuming.
He'll never show up, but maybe a nod towards Han Solo?
Maybe.
Because we know that he went back to his smuggling ways after Return of the Jedi.
Yeah.
And maybe he's wanted still. That's typically his MO.
Always a one.
He's never going to show up in the show, obviously. No. They'll probably never mention him again. Maybe, but if it old. Was, it might be a cool way for Filoni and Favreau to nod to him, because him and Chewie are doing their thing after Return of the Jedi. They won. They don't need to do anything but smuggle, like, which is what they know. But yeah, let's get to the meat of this real quick, because before we get to the ending, there's a big chunk in the center that means a lot to Star Wars. That means a lot to the Mandalorian, obviously. I love when he's walking through the town and everything. Really cool to kind of see all the realistic sets and the production of all of it. It's really just cool. It honestly, it looks like when you're running through like Mos Eisley in Battlefront 2, it looks like one of those like towns.
It does.
Like with the setups and everything. But you mentioned it. We go down to this like cave area underground.
Damon said it looks like a sewer.
Yeah, like underground bunker almost, essentially. Yeah. And he's walking through this hallway, and in the shadows, we're seeing helmets pop up, right?
Even on little kids.
Yeah, and they're popping up. They're kind of standing in the shadows, and then the camera pans around, and there's Mandalorians everywhere.
Yeah.
They're all in helmets. We see some with antennas. We see different designs.
And on the door was their symbol.
And then he's walking through the hallway, and he's walking down this hallway, and the camera cuts, and it's the dragon that the Mandalorians used to ride. That's the symbol they took on.
Yeah.
And that's the symbol that we know that the Mandalorians are of. And he meets this blacksmith, and he sits down and he has this conversation with the blacksmith. We don't have a name for the blacksmith. We don't know who she is. We know that it is a she. Mm-hmm. She has a really sweet helmet. Really, really dope helmet. I
love
helmet.
That purple hue.
Yeah, it's really cool. It's very samurai-y, which is a very obvious tone throughout the entire episode. They have a little bit of a conversation, but he hands the Calamari Flan, and he hands the Burksa, I believe it's called. I think it's Burksa. Burska? I'll have to look that up. You know,
the Mandalorian Steel.
The Mandalorian Steel, but it's like, it's their prized possession. It's like the one thing, it's like their holy grail. I looked this up, quickly. It's like their holy grail.
Yeah, it's what all the suits metal. Are made out of.
And essentially what it seems like is that his ultimate goal is to, because he gave up all the money he made.
Yeah.
And he talked about it, how he needs credits, like he needs the money, yeah, but he's giving it up for this stuff. He wants to upgrade himself. Yeah. And this, for me, is an even more indication that he's not a Mandalorian, because he's fully trying to embed himself in the Mandalorian culture, and how he may be trying to almost like earn the respect in a way. Because this is also where we see the flashback. So you're smiling over there, so you may have a different thought
because
about it.
You and I are usually pretty in sync with things, and I'm off. You and I are on different pages with this. I'm taking it as this, his armor is, I mean, Mandalorians, their pride and joy is their armor.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like, again, he never got that.
Because maybe he's not a Mandalorian.
Because I think it's because he was a, what do they call him? I called him
Foundling.
Foundling. He never got the armor passed from his family. He never got that whole thing.
See, what do you think that means, though? You don't think foundly means that he was an orphan?
I think it literally means found youngling, but youngling meaning just like a kid, like a young child.
So, but a foundling of Mandalorian, like of Mandalorian, like he's, yeah, a Mandalorian. Like
he was a Mandalorian child that was found.
We're gonna have to make some bets about this. This is more fun because it's a TV show.
Yeah.
See, I think he's a foundling of the fact that he's not a Mandalorian, and they're called foundlings when they're brought into the culture. They're brought into a family, yeah, or they're taken over from a family.
That's
from a different play. Because
I can see that.
I have a feeling that.
So you don't think he's a Mandalorian at all?
No. I have a feeling that his planet or town or family or whatever was wiped out by the Separatists during the Clone Wars, and he was found by the Mandalorians, or given to the Mandalorians, because he was put in a crate that was shown in the flashbacks. I think that they were attacked, and that's also a reason why he doesn't like droids, because the Separatists attacked him.
Oh, well, yeah, that. Yeah.
So it kind of, to me, it feels like he's not a Mandalorian, and that he's constantly trying to, he tried to take all that work from Greef Karga, right? And he was like, no, I can't give you all this. Like, slow down. He's, like, constantly trying to prove himself. Like, I feel like he's constantly trying to prove himself that he needs to be a Mandalorian. Like, he needs to be this bounty hunter. He needs to be the best in the parsec or possibly farther. And so...
See, now I took that as the same thing, except that he is this true Mandalorian that...
I guess we'll have to agree to disagree. But it's going to be an ongoing thing until we really find out. And I don't know if we'll ever find out.
You and I rarely disagree on things.
So, it's fun, though, because... We weren't expecting to get Mandalorians in this season, really. We were expecting to just get him.
The fact that I saw it, I was like,
"Yeah." So it's really cool.
He was gonna be cut dry, like, and the only one.
We're getting all this lore about everything and all this history about the Mandalorians. And a big thing about this as well, when they talked about the Birxa, I think it's what it's called. I'll have to look it up. She mentioned this great purge. Now, there's only two options for this. One, she's talking about the Jedi Purge.
Yeah.
Two, she's talking about a different kind of purge that had to do with the Mandalorians.
I think it's going to be like a Mandalorian purge.
Now, this is where it comes from. This is what I believe. Dave Filoni directed this episode. He's a huge part of this episode. He dealt with Rebels. In Rebels, the last time we saw the Mandalorians, they were rising up against the Empire on Mandalore.
That's what I think.
And I don't think it went too well. I think they probably lost. I think that the planet or the culture is in disarray, which is why they kind of feel like they're in hiding. I don't know. I mean, it's very possible that they could be talking about the Jedi Purge, because at this moment, that's the only purge that we know about that's been called the Purge. And so, I don't know. I mean, it's very interesting, but it could go either way.
I think, I'm trying to find that word.
I'll look it up right now.
I agree with you. I don't think it's anything to do with the Jedi. I think it's going to tie into Rebels. Like, that's going to be...
Beskar. That's what it was called. Beskar.
I think that's going to be its tie into Rebels, is whatever happened. And, I mean, Black Saber, all that shebang.
I don't know if we'll go that far.
No, I'm just saying, like, the story of, like, all of that time period. I don't ever expect to see the Black Saber on the show or anything. I'm just saying, like, that whole time frame that we had of them visiting Mandalore and something, like, after that is probably what that area is being referred to. I don't think we're ever going to see, like, that, like, Sabine's probably not going to just walk up on screen. Hopefully. I'm not opposed.
If we deal with Mandalore and the Purge and everything, she's obviously involved in
that.
She's
like,
there's no way she's not involved in
that. Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, I don't think it's anything to do with the Jedi whatsoever. I think they're going to, like, try to stay.
Well, the last scene may point otherwise to that. Before we get to that, though, let's talk about this big action scene at the end. There's obviously a little bit of stuff in the middle. More with Ugnolty, as I'm going to refer to him, because I don't know his real name at the moment. Learning to ride your favorite characters from the episode.
Borgs.
Borgs. Bork, bork, bork. Which kind of was like, I think it was a cool callback to like the old school Westerns learning to ride a horse or like a wild horse, but it was also kind of like a
not needed
an am moment. But the heart of this thing is when we get to this compound.
Use the Jedi mind trick.
Okay. we get to this compound where they're holding the asset, as they refer to, and you know, he's looking over, he's doing some recon, and we find IG-11. IG-11 walking up and doing his bidding.
It's so funny because the second before he showed up, I literally was about to turn to you and go, you think we're going to see IG-11 in this episode?
I can't describe... I cannot describe to you how perfect they captured this character.
Oh, it's literally...
The way he moves... Every part of his body, from toe to eyes, whatever, it all spins and moves in the perfect place and direction.
Oh, 100%.
I like that you can't really tell that it's Taika Waititi, but if you know that it's his voice.
If you know his voice, you can tell.
He was used perfectly. The best part about this, though, is the banter between him and Mando.
Mm-hmm.
Their banter, and clearly, I mean, I don't know if Taika did a motion capture. I imagine he probably did a little bit. But their banter, how quickly it kind of formed, it's really, really good. And it made for a really cool, fun moment.
He was like, oh, crap.
In a really fun moment in a really, like, action-packed scene.
Yeah.
Action-packed scene that was, like, really heavy and badass.
Dude, and his turns.
Yeah. The way he moved was brilliant. It was incredible. Absolutely brilliant.
It was awesome. Nick Nolte's character is Kuil.
Kuil.
K-U-I-L-L.
Yeah,
Kuil. Dude, IG-11.
I can't. And
it was.
This is a spoiler, obviously. We know that he gets shot at the end by Mando, but he will be back.
I hope, yeah.
He's a droid. He'll be back.
Yeah. It's funny because I've always remembered the IG droids because of the old Nintendo 64 game, Shadows of the Empire. Because I could never freaking beat this one level that had those droids in it. And so, like, now seeing them, like, it's literally like if it was taken out of my mind and thrown onto the TV screen because, like, those things are perfect. How they did that is absolutely... His eyes rotate, everything rotate, the guns, like...
It was all moving in a different direction.
Yeah, it's wild. It was wild. Like, I mean, you don't... when you think of a droid bounty hunter, you're like, okay.
Yeah.
But, like, I would not want to come across one of those things. Like, those things... That part was probably my favorite part of the whole thing.
Yeah, it was good.
That
was
fight really, really, scene really that good. They were... just holding him off and how he kept wanting to self-destruct.
That will for sure come back.
Oh, 100%. It's 100%.
The character probably won't make it out of the season.
Probably not.
And he'll probably die by the hands of his self-destruct. But that leads us to the big part of the episode. And we had heard a few weeks ago that the first episode was going to reveal a giant mystery of Star Wars, right?
And boy, were we wrong.
We don't know if it did or if this is what they were talking about, but the asset that Werner Herzog gives him, the Imperial dude from the planet where he gets the bounty, it's a 50-year-old Yoda species.
It's one of these.
And the cool thing about this is that for the 45 years that Star Wars has been going on, Yoda species has never been given a name.
No.
And more than likely, we will now be given a name at some point in the series. Because it seems like this is going to be the core central part of the season due to how it happened, because not only did they not kill the Baby Yoda, when we're going to call him Baby Yoda for the sake of the argument, because it's just easier.
There's literally no name.
But he also shot and stole the bounty from IG-11, which is against the code. And so he could very well be on the run, saving Baby Yoda. Maybe that's where he meets Cara Dune. Maybe this is where he meets all these other characters. Don't know.
Surprised she wasn't in this?
No, not surprised. Not surprised. It's how a TV show works. Yeah. It's not like a movie. You know, there's a lot of other time to kind of play through it.
For a half second, I was like, oh, maybe he's going to go after her. But then once they said the 50-year-old, I was like, there's no way she's going to be 50 years old. Because that would have been kind of like a wild, like, I almost was like, oh, maybe she's going to be the one that he goes after, then befriends, and da 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 da. But then once they said...
This is a whole different ballgame. This is a whole different ballgame. Now, a little background on Yoda's species. There's only been really two connections with them. Yoda and, I want to say, Yemet or Yedet or something along that lines. I'm totally butchering the name, I'm sure. But the key here is that their species, they're basically almost in a way connected to the Force.
Yeah.
It's almost like it's almost like a God-given right to them. Like, it's almost passed down through generations in a way. And not all of them, but more than half, much more than half, have some kind of Force abilities. And the two that we've ever met in Star Wars, one canon, one non-canon, have had Force abilities. And this could very well be the same. Now, obviously, it being 50 years old is old to us, but in their years is very young. Yoda was 900 some odd years old when he died. So how that's going to play in, I don't know.
He was literally a baby in a cradle.
But if it does connect to the Force, this is a big revelation. Big revelation.
I have a hard time believing that it'll come out, that the baby will somehow, like, survive the whole way through, like, the whole show. Because, like, to have one of those things running around would be kind of a big freaking deal. So, like, that's who knows how they could, like, play that one out. But, like, I feel like we would have known if there was another, like, Yoda Force species at some point. Like, something. Like, a mention. A name drop. Something. It's kind of a huge deal, like, for them to show that. And we were so far off of our guess.
Well, we don't know if this is actually what they're talking about, though.
I would imagine so. Although the only thing is, like, the only question I would see answered would be, are there other Yodas? Which I never really asked that question.
Yeah. The other big part of this is what Werner Herzog and the Doctor want with it, right? Yeah. Werner Herzog said, kill it, bring it alive if you have to, right? See, it doesn't seem like
wanted it alive. Werner Herzog was like,
yeah, so Werner Herzog was like, don't really care for it, you know, do what you want with it. If you need to kill it, whatever. But the Doctor obviously wants it for some reason. Maybe they know what their species is able to do. Maybe they know because of Yoda. Maybe they know because of something else.
Palpatine.
But it's obviously going to play into it somehow. And it's big because it sets up these following episodes with how Mando is going to be, how he's going to be, what's the word?
Protecting?
No, how he's going to be chased, I guess you could say, by these other characters. Because now, not only has he broken the bounty hunter code, which Greef Karga, Carl Weathers' character, and IG-11 is more than likely going to be coming after him, but so are the Imperials, which is where Giancarlo Esposito comes into it as well. And the Death Troopers and all that. And so it sets up a lot, and this next episode is going to be very telling. It's directed by Rick Fumiyawa, who directed Dope. And so it comes out on Friday. We don't know what time it drops, but we're going to be doing an episode then as well.
Probably midnight.
It's going to be very telling. I heard that it might be dropping at 6 p.m. They might be dropping them like actual TV shows.
I was surprised they dropped it the second Disney Plus came out yesterday.
Well, that's not surprising with the service dropping, though, to kind of give it a sway. So,
one was right about it when the time.
What I'm saying is they weren't going to drop the service at midnight and then drop The Mandalorian at 6 p.m. They were going to drop them together. So this could very well change now that it's been 4 days after the service dropped. A lot of questions. A lot of
curiosities,
not a lot of answers at the moment. Very cool action, good tone, very different in Star Wars, which is what we wanted. The score is fantastic, except for one stupid boxing Creed sounding thing. It's the same score. It's the same composer from the Creed movies. So
I didn't hear it at all.
There's a moment that sounds like a Creed and Rocky movie in there, which really annoyed me, but because it was all samurai-y and stuff like that. Super Western leading up to that, and then it kind of just like dropped that in there and it threw me off. I would have loved to have heard a variation of the whistling Western from back in the day. That would have been super cool because the first time we see him when the door opens, And he's just standing there like a guy coming into a saloon. Like, yeah, like a guy coming into a saloon back in the day. That's what it felt like. And I would have loved to have been like maybe a leaf blows by or something. That would have been so cool.
Frozen planet?
Yeah, you never know. Yeah. You never know. Any last thoughts? First episode of Mandalorian?
I'm excited. I want to know more.
Obviously.
You asked me my thoughts. I want to know more. I like that I don't really know where this is going. Mm-hmm. I like how it's not predictable so far. I mean, it has its predictable elements in the sense of, like, now he's going to try to get on the Bork, and now he's going to have a bar scene. But, like, as far as the main story, I have no idea what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, I would assume the shooting the IG-11 in the head is going to have a play into it. Obviously, the Baby Yoda is going to have a play into it. But outside of that, like, I have no idea where we're going.
Yeah, it'll be fun. Hopefully, we get more Mandalorian stuff. Hopefully, we get a lot more
Living planet. I want to know more about the ones that are living under the city. That's honestly probably the thing I'm most intrigued about more than anything.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you. And
That's your number one?
I don't know if you know this, but Mandalorians are probably one of my all-time favorite things in Star Wars.
Well, I know you. Yeah, Boba Fett's like your top three. Mm-hmm. So.
And this is all coming from Legends stuff because we haven't seen a lot of it in canon.
Yeah.
Or the new canon, I should say. They've kind of been kept out of it as far as the movies go. We've seen it in Clone Wars and Rebels, but they haven't really been thrown into the fire as far as, like, being in the spotlight, and this kind of seems to be the connection. Whether or not we get there now or later, I'm not sure, but hopefully we do. It's a good start, though, getting that underground bunker with them. It's really cool to kind of see what happens. But for now, I mean, we're left with questions, and hopefully we get answers, and it's very exciting. I mean, the first ever live-action TV show has gotten off to a hot start. It's really, really cool.
The one thing I kept saying there is, like, holy crap. This is going to happen with Obi-Wan. Like, it's going to be freaking wild.
Not next year. 2021, I imagine. Yeah, it'll be really cool.
I'm excited.
Super pumped. All right, guys. Well, there it is. Our first episode of the Fandalorian Club. Make sure you guys let us know what you think of it down below in the comments. Hit that like and share button, of course. And subscribe if you want to, if you want to join us for the conversation every week. Again, we're going to have two this week and one the following weeks as the episodes drop. Make sure you guys hit that. Check us out on social media. All of our podcast sections as well, which you can see up here in the corner, wrong way. There we go. Right there. And so for Brian, for myself, thank you for joining us on Apocalypse Movies and the Fandalorian Club. God, I want to say the Fandalorian Podcast for some reason. It's just so synonymous with us.
Yeah.
The Fandalorian Club. Fandalorian Club. Let us know what you guys think of that name, by the way. We kind of came up with it randomly. So
you came up with it. It was just...
Well, it's kind of been brewing for a little while, but yeah. You know. But yeah, thank you for joining us, and we'll see you guys next time.
Hey, everyone. Jacob Bartlett here. Thanks for watching. If you want to check out something similar from Apocalypse Movies, click this video up here. If you want something a little bit different, check out this video down here. If you haven't done so, please subscribe to Apocalypse Movies and let us know your thoughts in the comments section. We always love to hear from you. Thanks for watching.